Let us pray. Our God and our Father, we are praying this time that you'll give us the wisdom to live our lives with eternity in view. Do this for us, O Lord, and we'll be eternally grateful unto you. In Jesus' name we pray. From 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I read verse 19 and verse 32. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Verse 32. If after the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantages it me if the dead rise not? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we shall die. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 12. That at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, without God in the world. We are considering the message, living with eternity in view. The opposite of that is living without eternity in view. Living as if this world were the only world to which or of which you are concerned. As if this is the only life there is. As if there were no life beyond the grave. As if there will be no existence in eternity. How do such people live? The people that do not have eternity in view. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most miserable. The people that do not know anything about eternity. The people that do not know that we continue to live, we continue to be in existence throughout all eternity, that life does not end here. They live miserable lives. If they are persecuted, they have no hope. If they have problems, they have no hope. If they are poor, they have no hope. If friends forsake them, they have no hope. If difficulties confront them, they have no hope. They are so miserable that sometimes they feel there is nothing to live for, and some of them commit suicide. They are so dejected because they do not see any ray of light, any hope in the future. They think all there is now, because they live only in this world and for this world and for the things of the present age. Obviously, Christians should not live like that. But there were Christians at Corinth that did not have the hope of resurrection, or the hope of life eternal, or the hope of living with God eternally. And therefore they were living lives as if there was no future after death. And Paul the apostle told them, if they were living like that, they will be of all men the most miserable. I dare tell you that there are many people in the church today who think that there is nothing to live for except what you can see, what you can taste, what you can touch, what you can feel, what you can enjoy for the present time. If they get healed, they are joyful. If they get some money, they are happy. If they are praised by the people of the world, they are very happy. If they have things of this world, their lives are fully satisfied. They do not have anything they desire, anything they want, anything they are praying for beyond what they can expect for now. Of all men, they are the most miserable. In verse 32, the apostle Paul said, if after the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantages it me if the dead rise not? In other words, Paul the apostle was saying, You found me fighting with beasts at Ephesus. You found me contending against beastly men and women. You found me contending with people that have the animal nature, the beastly nature, the ferocious nature in them. Why do I do that? What will be the advantage for me if I contend against beastly men that manifest the animal nature, if it were not for the hope of the dead rising again? What the Apostle Paul is saying is this: if there were no future, if there were no life after death, if I do not have eternity in view, I will not fight. I will not contend. I will not bother myself contending against men and women that have the beastly nature. What I will do is that I will eat and drink, because I know that tomorrow I will die. Isn't that the attitude of people who do not have eternity in view? They say, let's eat and drink. They say it's only what you have now that you can show for your labor. They say it's only what you receive now of the rewards of your labor on earth that you can only enjoy, because beyond life or beyond death, there is nothing else. Therefore, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. These are the attitudes of people that have no hope in God, that do not believe there is eternity for which to prepare. I read to you from Ephesians chapter 2 and in verse 12, the lifestyle of Gentiles that have no future, that have no hope, that do not think about eternity. It says that at that time ye were without Christ. You know, if you do not have anybody outside your city that you are thinking about who loves you, you never think about wanting to go to that place. Let's say, for example, you've heard about America, you've read about America, you've seen a map of America, perhaps, but you don't have anything doing there. You don't have anybody there. You don't have anything there. You never think about America, because there is no person there that you are interested in. And the people that do not have Christ, they never think about heaven, because they don't have anybody in heaven that they are thinking about. If they hear about heaven at all, it doesn't register on their conscience of mind, because they are living without Christ. But for the people that know that Christ said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go there now to prepare a place for you. You'll be living with eternity in view. You will know that there is a world in view where you are going, and you will be living with the consciousness that one of these days Christ will come and he will take you home. But if you don't know there is any mansion in heaven, no home in heaven, no Christ in heaven for you, you'll think that your home is here. The world will be your home. All your excitement will be on the things that are happening in this world. The news of the world will be the best news you could ever hear. And it says, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope, no future. You see, that's the life of Gentiles. They live for the life that now is, for politics. There's no other thing they can think about. It's only the governments of the world they can think and plan about, because they do not have any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ. They have no hope. They can only think about money. For them, the greatest possession is not salvation. For them, the greatest possession is not Christ. For them, the greatest possession is not life eternal. For them, the greatest possession is money. They don't have any hope beyond having money, without hope. Beyond politics, or beside from politics, besides money, or apart from money, all they can think about will be enjoyment and entertainment for the satisfaction of the flesh, because they do not have any hope for their spirit, for their heart. There is no future for them. They do not know about the resurrection. All they can think about is what their flesh will derive now. That's the life of unbelievers. Unfortunately, that's the life of many churchgoers, many Bible readers, and many people that are called by the name of deeper life. Money, politics, fleshly enjoyment, together with fleshly enjoyment you have, men or women, if you are a man, and you have no hope, and your body is desiring something, since you are not living with eternity in view, all you will think about will be how to satisfy that flesh, legitimately or illegitimately. And therefore your body will be craving for women, if you are a man. And since there is no hope, since you don't know about the resurrection, about life eternal, what do? Whatever the body wants to give. And if you are a woman, you'll be desiring for men as well. And it says, without God in the world. Practically, you'll be like an atheist. You do not know of the existence of the eternal God, because you do not live with eternity in view. But I'm here to tell you today that you should always live with eternity in view. Now, if you could do this every time you wake up in the morning, remember, life will soon end. Where will I spend eternity? Anytime you're at a crossroad, remember, this confusion or difficulty will not continue forever. Time, life will soon end. Where will I spend eternity? Anytime you are about to take a decision, decision about work, decision in your place of work, decision about marriage, decision about whatever action you want to do, think about this. Life will soon end. Where will I spend eternity? Anytime you are confronted with the message of Christ, the message of the Word of God, and you wonder what should my attitude be, remember, life will soon end. Where will I spend eternity? Anytime you are challenged in the Word of God as to arising and obeying the Word of God, doing the will of God, and your flesh is trying to pull back, just remember, life will soon end. Where will I spend eternity? You see, friends, no matter how long life seems to be, like Methuselah, more than 900 years, life ended for him. No matter what difficulties you are having, like Job, life sometimes might appear difficult, might appear full of problems, but life will end. You might be like Jacob, that the problems of life all spark up like fire, like flame all around you, that you can say like Jacob, that the years of my life have not been as yet the lives of the fathers of my fathers, but they have been full of trouble. But remember, one day he died, life will soon end. He might be a man of power and authority like Pharaoh. If you say that those children will die, they die. You might be a person of authority like Herod over children of men, that you can even give a word and then there will be cry in Ramah. Rachel weeping for her children because she will not be comforted, because you have the authority to command that they should be killed. But one day Herod died. Wherever you find yourself, whoever you find yourself to be, a man of authority, a man of wealth, a man of position, a man of great privileges in life, remember, life will end. Where will you spend eternity? And so it's important that as a person that has the knowledge of the Word of God, and you know the Word of God is the true Word, you should live your life with eternity in view. Number one, we need to realize that death is certain, but death is not the end of existence. Death is sure, death is certain, but death is not the end of your existence. Let's see the fact that death is sure. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, and as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. It is appointed unto men once to die. The word appointed means that God has decreed that there will be death happening to all created things. That just means the separation of the soul from the body In which case, the body will not continue to enjoy life, physical life, in the world that now is. In James chapter 2 verse 26, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. It is when your spirit gets out of your body, is separated from your body, that we say death has occurred. And the word of God says death, separation of body from soul, or spirit from body, is appointed, is decreed unto men. It is appointed unto men once to die. And do you know that a great, great religious people, they die too? And as you think about this, it makes you to want to spend your life with eternity in view. You might be a pope, a leader over millions of people, religious people, that do not accept Jesus as their personal savior, and yet it's a powerful religion. Yet popes do die. It is appointed unto men once to die. Or you might be an evangelical believer. You have a great opportunity already. You know Christ as your personal savior. But can I remind you, the greatest of all evangelicals, the leader of the Reformation, Martin Luther, he died too. You might believe in holiness like John Wesley. It's appointed unto all men, saint or sinner. John Wesley also died. Charles G. Finney, a man that had the great power of God in his life. That was the day that he died too. Those of us who appear young now, a day will come when eventually the rapture has not taken place, you will die. It is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. When you find life too important, too interesting to you, ask yourself a question. How interesting will this entertainment or enjoyment be on the day of death? Ask yourself, on the day when the Lord will require my soul to be separated from my body, how important will this wealth or money be? You see, sometimes your body will be telling you that if you don't see women now or get to women now, well, you may not be able to enjoy all that you want. And maybe you are not married. And your body will be telling you, well, why don't you just go for any woman wherever you can see the woman? Ask yourself, on the day of death, how important will this enjoyment be? Sometimes you have a wife, and the wife may be now, because you've been together for 1 year or 2 years, she's no more beautiful to you, although she is still beautiful and nice in the eyes of other people. But because you've seen her every day for 2 years, maybe you have become carnal, like natural men, and then she is not beautiful enough to you anymore now, and you think, I must go out to meet other women. Ask yourself, on the day when the Lord will require my soul from my body, how important will this thing be? In Luke chapter 12, from verse 16, and he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he brought a thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater. And there I will bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. You see, that is the description of the life that is lived without eternity in view. The man that Jesus spoke about here did not know about eternity. Did not know of existence beyond this life. And he said, this will I do. Isn't that the language of many people? Teenage boy, teenage girl, this will I do. I will go to school. I will get to college. I will get certificate, I will make my grades, then I will work, then I will build a house, then I will have children, then I will enjoy my life, then I will relax, then I will ride in the best car available, then I will travel to America or Japan or Tokyo, then I will travel all over and just entertain myself for sightseeing, and then I will lead. I'll be a politician. When I come back to Nigeria, I'll be a great man. My friend, after that, what? On the day of death, how important with all the touring, how important with all the sightseeing, how important with all the things you have enjoyed in life, how important will that be? This will I do. That's the language of many young people in the church. And they say, well, all this salvation they are talking about, I'm too young to consider that. Life is in front of me. This I will do. I will find the best man, the richest man, the wealthiest man in town, and I will marry him. I know what they are preaching. Don't marry unbeliever. Don't marry unbeliever. Well, I will live my life. I'm not going to allow one pastor to dictate how I will live my life for me. I will marry the wealthiest man in town. And then, well, I have a big mansion, a big house, air-conditioned room, boys' quarters, servants, drivers, everybody, washing machine, gadgets, fridge, refrigerator, television, everything that I want. I don't want all this doctrine to spoil my life for me. My friend, after that, what? After you have got all the enjoyment, you will not eat more than your stomach will take. You will not sleep on two beds at a time. You will not sleep beyond maybe 9 p.m. to 6 a.m. in the morning. If you do, your body will react against it. Even if you want to drink alcohol, you are not going to drink more than your tummy will take. You have to stop one day. Even if you want to travel outside, that's all right for you. But you will not travel more than the world. You cannot go and travel and live in the moon now. So after all this traveling and touring and enjoyment, after that, what? The man said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and I will build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease. Eat, drink, be merry. But God said, he lived without God. But God said, he lived as if there were no eternity. But God said, he lived as if this natural life is all there is. But God said unto him, thou fool, are we not fools for thinking only about education and not about heaven? Are we not fools for thinking only about entertainment and enjoyment and not thinking about where we shall spend eternity? Are we not fools for relegating God and Christ and the Bible and salvation and eternal life at the background and thinking I will enjoy my life now? Are we not fools? Are we not fools for thinking I will build greater, I will have possession, I will have this or that, and we are not thinking about where we shall spend eternity? Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then who shall these things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Remember what I've told you, that it's appointed unto men once to die. Then after this, there is judgment. Death is certain, but death is not the end of existence. In John chapter 5, verse 28 and verse 29. John 5:28-29. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming, in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice, and shall come forth, they that have done good, unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil, unto the resurrection of damnation. Marvel not at this. That is, this may surprise you. It may look mysterious to you. It may look impossible for you. It may seem as if it cannot be fulfilled. But then Jesus said, the hour is coming. The time is coming. Think about that. You see, sometimes the hour of any event that is fixed but in the future is always far, far away. Do you remember the time you heard about the retreat, the hour, the time, the period of the retreat, when you were told it was so far away, you didn't know how to think about it. Even though the preachers, the pastors spoke about it and preached about it, it was still far away for you. You didn't pack your load. You didn't organize yourself. Maybe you didn't even prepare to save the money that you will need. You see, the future is always far for us. Just like our students at school. You tell them that in a few years' time you'll be taking your final exam. It's so far away for them, they cannot think about it. They cannot prepare for that exam. You want to travel, and the time is so far away for you, you never make any preparation. The time that Jesus is talking about is very near for everyone, and yet we never think about it. But he said, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming, in the which all that are in the graves, all saints and sinners, the righteous and the unrighteous, all. Death does not terminate your existence. You will continue to live even after you have died. But it says then, they that have done good, and you know there is none good except by the grace of God. They that have done good, you know nobody can do good except by salvation in Christ. Because there is none good except one, even God. And whosoever God will impart and impute goodness unto. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation, which means everybody will be resurrected. Everybody will be resurrected. The saints will be resurrected. The sinners will be resurrected. The saints will have the resurrection of life. The sinners will have the resurrection of damnation. Which means, whether you are a saint or a sinner, death does not stop your existence. A resurrection will take place and you will continue to live forever. Let's talk about the eternal existence of sinners to start with. Then I will talk about eternal existence of those who are saved after that. Eternal existence of sinners. Let's suppose for a moment that you rebel, you reject the word of salvation. Let's suppose for some moment that you do not give your life to the Lord. Let's even suppose that you continue going to the church, you refuse the word of salvation. Let's suppose that the preachers and the pastors come to you to plead with you, and you tell them, I'm sorry, I don't have time for that now. I'll keep on coming to church, but I don't have time now to consider salvation. Salvation is too costly for me. It's going to make me deny myself of this, this and that. And I'm not ready for that now. Let's just suppose that you continue like that until the very time you are about to die. And then at the time you are about to die, you remember that, well, this salvation they are talking about, maybe I should think about it. But you are sick, you're having pains, you're on the hospital bed, you are about to die. On the one hand, you want to pray so you can be saved. On the other hand, the pain is too much in your body. You cannot concentrate. You did not seek the Lord when he could be found, while he was near. Now that you are trying to seek the Lord, the sickness and the pain and the terminal disease will not allow you to pray. Eventually, while you are struggling between life and death, you try to call Jesus, but you have forgotten everything we said about Jesus Christ. And then all the restitution you should have made, all the repentance you want to repent, everything becomes a heavy load upon you. And you say, had I known, I would have repented. But the time is gone. The death angel comes and he says, hurry up. You must follow me now. Eventually you close your eyes in death. You do not become a Christian. Where will you live after that? I'll show you. Mark chapter 9 from verse 43. And if thine hand offend thee, cut it off, for it is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. If you die as a sinner, you will be in the burning lake of fire forever and ever. You will be burning, you will never burn up. You'll be feeling the pain of the fire, but it will never consume your body. It will be burning. And right in that burning, the fire will be painful, and yet it will not kill, because it's appointed unto men once to die. You cannot die twice. You die once. After your resurrection, you live forever. After resurrection, you cannot kill yourself. Satan cannot kill you, and the fire of hell cannot kill you. You will live forever in that hell fire. In verse 45, and if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter halt into life than having 2 feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. That is, the cells of your body will never be destroyed, will never be annihilated, will never be put out of existence. The worm dies not, and the fire keeps on burning. The fire is not quenched. If thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. For it is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having 2 eyes to be cast into hell fire, where their worm dies not, and the fire is not quenched. What does it mean to live with eternity in view? What it means is this: you have a right-hand man very close to you. That's what Jesus called the hand here. The right-hand man, very close, very profitable, very useful, like your hand, very serviceable. But he always puts you into sin. He always influences you committing sin, to gossip, to hate, to be bitter. Or this right-hand man is always inviting you to commit adultery or fornication. Or this right-hand man is always telling you to do something that is offensive to God and to the law of God. If you are going to live with eternity in view, you cut him off. Because it's better for you to cut off the right-hand man, wealthy man, the right-hand man, useful man, the right-hand woman, profitable woman, cut her off so you can preserve your life, eternal life. Remain saved rather than you keep him or you keep her and you go to hell. You see, sometimes in the denomination where you were before, it may so happen that the occultic prophet was a right-hand man to you. It may so happen that the prophetess prophesying lies was a right-hand woman to you. And then you had the word of salvation. You said, I will leave occultism. I will leave Satan. I will leave darkness. I will go into the gospel church and live my life for Christ. But the prophet or the prophetess, your right-hand man, your right-hand woman, says, will you leave? Will you leave? Will you leave us? Don't you know we love you so much? Don't you know I don't think we can ever part? Well, better cut her up, cut him up, so you can get to heaven. You see, it may so happen that there is a sin partner, and you know, it's also coming to our church. But in the secret, every time you hear the word of God and you cry and you weep and you say, I will not go into this sin anymore, immediately after the service, after you have cried and wept and you have said, my life is dirty, this man who says he's also a member of our church is always pulling me back into immorality, and I'm going to make right my life. I'm even going to confess this sin. I'm going to tell the pastor. I'm going to damn the consequence. I'm going to get to heaven. Immediately after you have prayed and wept like that, immediately you come out of the church, the man is waiting for you outside and sees your eyes red, swollen because of weeping tears of repentance. And the man says, what's the matter with you? Is it because of that thing they preached? Don't mind all those things. Oh, you say, no, I'm going to make right my life. I want to get to heaven. I'm going to just make right. If you do that, I will die. If you do that, then it means that you don't like me, you will kill me. If you separate from me, I cannot live. Don't you know I'm your right hand? Don't you know I'm so precious to you like your eye? Don't you know that I'm the one that is like your feet, that you are walking with, helping you to make progress? So you will do like that to me. You will report all these evil things you have been doing in secret. If you do that, I will commit suicide. If you do that, I will backslide. If you do that, I will never come to church again. If you do that, I will never read Bible again. If you do that, I will forsake Christ. And then you will be the one that sent me to hell. You know, that man will be talking to you and make you afraid not to be able to make right your life. You say, what will I do now? This man sticks to me like a right hand, difficult to cut off. This man sticks to me like the right eye, like the right hand, like the right foot, difficult to cut off. If you don't cut him off, eternity will teach you an eternal lesson you will never forget. You will cry, you will weep in the flames of fire. For your tongue to be cooled in this flame, there will be no drop of water given to you. You lost your chance. Why don't you live with eternity in view, whatever will happen? Well, they say, well, if I confess that sin, I will have shame. What a shame. Think about this, that David, when Nathan came to him, he told him the parable. He said, you know, this and that. And David said, who is the man that can do that in Israel? Then he brought judgment. And Nathan said, thou art the man. Oh, and David said, I have sinned. I've done wrong. Now tell me, was it not shameful for the king of Israel to confess, I accept, I'm a sinner. I accept, I did that terrible, terrible thing. Well, it was shameful only for a few days, only for a few weeks, only for a few months, only for a few years. David has gone now. Where is the shame now? We read about it now, but it's now in heaven. It's now with God. That shame is temporary. You have become pregnant out of marriage. Don't tell a lie to cover it up. Oh, if I confess, it will be shameful on me. Yes, I know that. But the shame will be for a few weeks. Just repent and make right your life. People will look at you and say, somebody were calling sister so and so can do that. The shame is only for a few days. The shame is only for a few months. If I do that, they will discipline me. That's all right. That's all right. They will discipline me. That's only for a few months. Isn't it better? Cut off that right hand. Cut off that right foot. Pluck out that right eye. And have the shame just for a short period of time. And then when you die, you go to live in heaven. Let's look at Matthew chapter 25. From verse 41. Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. He will say to these selfish people, stingy people, the people that saw him and hungered and they gave him no meat, the people that saw him thirsty and they gave him no drink, the people that saw him a stranger and they took him not in, the people that saw him naked and they clothed him not, the people that saw him sick and in prison and they visited him not. You see, the lives of many people are lived in selfishness. They never give any part of their substance or food or money or clothing or time or talent for the benefit of other people. And Jesus said that on the last day, he will tell them, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire. And I must ask you, you have a lot of talents and a lot of gifts. Do you ever give it out for the benefit of other people? You have the message of salvation. Do you ever give it out for the benefit of those who are not saved? You have the knowledge of the Bible. Do you ever give it out for the knowledge of those who are in ignorance? You have the message of deliverance. Do you ever give it out for those who are in prison and in captivity? If not, on the last day you will hear, you did not live your life with eternity in view. Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Verse 46, these shall go away into everlasting punishment. Revelation chapter 14, verse 11, and the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark
of his name. Those who serve the Antichrist and do not serve Christ. Those who have the spirit of Antichrist, they do not have the spirit of Christ. You cannot be neutral. You are either for Christ or for the Antichrist. You are either having the spirit of Christ or the spirit of the Antichrist. Little children, now it is the last time. And I see a father, the Antichrist shall come. Even so now are there many Antichrists. Thereby we know that it is the last time. We know that there are many Antichrists now. And if you are serving that Antichrist, you are serving the beast, you are not serving Christ. It says, the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. They have no rest, day nor night. The next time you are tempted to deny Christ, think about the fact that one day you will die. After death, where will you spend eternity? The next time you are tempted to receive the attitude, the spirit, the motivating factor in the Antichrist into you to become a little Antichrist, remember, one day you will die. And after death, where will you spend eternity? The next time you are tempted to become a partner to people that are opposing Christ, to people that are running away from Christ, the next time you are tempted in your language, in your attitude, in your action, to oppose the doctrine of Christ, remember, you can oppose today, but one day you will die. After death, where will you spend eternity? Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. Daniel 12:2. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. Friends, all the sins you are trying to hide today, so you will not have shame, will be revealed on the last day. And that time you will wake up to everlasting shame and everlasting contempt. Are you a preacher and you are living in immorality with ladies in the church and people don't know it today and you cover up? Well, maybe you can avoid coming under shame today, but on that day you will wake up to everlasting shame. We will know one another in heaven. There will be years, thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of years, millennia. For eternity, we'll just be in heaven together. We will know who is absent. If we don't see you the first day, we'll be looking for you the second day, first year, 100 years, 1,000 years. All through eternity, we'll search all the mansions and all the streets of gold, and we cannot find you. Then there will be everlasting shame. Then those of us who get to heaven will be talking to one another. Do you remember Sister so-and-so, how she used to lead chorus, how she used to lead prayer meeting, how she used to be very authoritative and preaching the word of God? Oh yes, we remember. Oh, we didn't know she will never make it. And then everybody will have you in contempt. All those things you are hiding, we will know them. Oh, we will say, she didn't make it because she was living in immorality secretly. She was having pride and bitterness and hatred secretly. Oh, we didn't know that all that type of preaching and ministration. We didn't know that that lady was just a hypocrite. Or maybe you are a man. And when you come up here to preach, people just shout and say that's the voice of God. But internally, you are a rotten man, corrupt man, polluted, defiled man. You have corruption and dead men's bones inside you. You live hypocritical life. You live in sin. You have defiled many women. And whenever you preach, people will cry and pray and bow down and say, oh God, let me make heaven. You will be like the people at the car park that tell people to get into the vehicle and then the vehicle takes them away. You are not going anywhere. And you know, when we get to heaven, we'll see one another, we'll know one another. Where is house fellowship leader so-and-so? So where is zonal leader so-and-so? He didn't make it. He didn't live with eternity in view. Oh, we'll know it on that day. And it is not long. The time is coming. Very, very soon. We will soon die. Time is short. Time is not too long. Apart from that, the rapture will soon take place. When those who are ready, those who are living righteously, they will be taken out of this world. My friend, on that day, where will you be? What is your conscience telling you now? Should something happen now and you die right now, where will you spend eternity? Should the trumpet sound now and the voice of the archangel is heard now and Christ takes the saints home, where will you be? Will you be among the people that will have everlasting shame, everlasting contempt? You carry Bible, but they have your name in the attendance of the people that are visiting prostitutes. The prostitutes know your name. The prostitutes have your money. You visit them. You go to them. And here you are carrying Bible. And you are walking in the kitchen. Or you are walking among those who are serving food. Well, that day will reveal it. When everything will be plain. When we will know everything that has ever been hidden. There will be no mystery. There will be no hidden thing. And those who are right with God, righteous in Christ, they will rejoice forever and ever. But those who are hypocrites, Pharisees, churchgoers, nominal Christians, members of deeper life in name, but they don't know God. They don't fear God. In secret, they live like an animal, like dogs and pigs. But openly, they don't wear jewelry. Say, well, I don't watch television. I don't do this. I don't do this. In hell, you'll go and be telling your companions in hell you didn't watch television. You'll be telling your companions in hell you are not smoking, you are not drinking. What a shame it will be forever and ever. And the people will tease you. The people, they will torture you. They will say, deeper life member, what are you doing here? You attended every retreat they organized in deeper life. You had Bible from every preacher that preached in deeper life. You have all your shelves tied with cassette and with deeper life books, and you are still here in hell. You have Dick's Bible. You have Thompson's Chain Reference Bible. You have small Bible, big Bible, annotated Bible, amplified Bible, every type of Bible, language Bible, English Bible, with all the Bible you carried in your house. What are you doing here? What will you tell them? Let's rise up and pray. Where will you spend eternity? Will you be in heaven? When Christ will come, will you be in heaven? When Christ will call his own home, will you be among the people of God? Are you a child of God? Are you born again? Are you living a righteous life? Are you living with eternity in view? Is Jesus your Savior? Is Jesus your Lord? Are you living a life in the secret, in the public, that when Jesus will come, he will take you home? Or are you a hypocrite? Are you a hypocrite? Are you a hypocrite? Are you living with heaven in view? Are you a child of God? Where will you be on that day? When the trumpet has sounded, when we have heard the voice of the archangel, when the dead in Christ shall rise forth, and we which are alive shall be caught up together with them to be with the Lord forever and ever. Where will you be on that day? Seeing that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of men and women ought we to be in all holy conversation, because all the elements of this world will be melted away? What type of life are you living in preparation for the coming of the Lord? Are you a real Christian? Are you born again? Are you a child of God? Are you living a clean life? Are you living a pure life? Are you living with eternity in view?